Are you tired of seeing the standard poseur sprite every time you play or battle? Wanna spice things up a little with something more unique and exciting? Well, you've come to the right place. This tutorial will cover the basics of sprites in Unitale. We will go over where and how to store them, how to move them, and lastly, how to animate them. If you like this video, you know what to do. Subscribe, hit the bell, and join my Discord. Before we can use sprites, we need to save them in a specific location. All sprites need to be PNGs and have to be stored in the Sprites folder of your mod. To follow along with this tutorial, download the sprites from the link in the description. I won't be talking about sprite creation in this video, just how to use already existing ones. The sprite pack you've hopefully just downloaded contains 5 sprites, 3 for different facial expressions and 2 for the rest of the body. When combined, we get Underfell Papyrus. Let's start by creating a new folder inside of a Lua folder called Animations. Inside of it, create a new Lua script called papyrusanim.lua. We'll write all the code in this episode here. We will start by adding the legs. To add a sprite, we need to create a new sprite object with the createSprite function. The only required argument for this function is the image that the sprite will use. In our case, it's legs without the .png at the end. To make our legs show up in-game, we need to include the animation file inside of our encounter script. We use the require keyword for that and add the path of the animation script afterwards, without the lua at the end. When we play our mod, we see that a sprite has been created at the center of the screen, right above the arena. But our poseur sprite is still in the way. To remove it, set the sprite variable in our monster file to empty. This is a transparent image, so our monster sprite is now invisible. It's always available and doesn't need to be in the sprites folder. Let's move the legs up a bit. Moving sprites is just like moving bullets. Call the move function and move the sprite 30 pixels up. You can also set x and y values directly, but setting a sprite's location to x equals 0 and y equals 30 would position it relative to the bottom left corner of the screen, which is not what we want. The move function, on the other hand, moves the sprite a certain amount of pixels from its current location. Let's add our two other sprites the same way and move them slightly higher each time, so they're not on top of each other. Our character has been assembled, but he's rather static. Let's add some animation. There are two ways to animate in Unitale. The first is to move, rotate, and scale the individual sprites. The second is to replace a sprite with another one. Combining both techniques yields the best results, so we'll use both. Let's start by moving the legs around a little to create some movement. For that, we need a function which runs every frame. Create a function called animatePapyrus inside of our animation script and add the update function to our encounter script. Like in the wave scripts, the update function runs every frame here as well. You need to reference the animatePapyrus function in here so our character will actually animate. Let's add some animation code to it. If we move the legs to the right continuously, you will notice a glaring issue. The body and head don't move with the legs, even though that's what we expect them to do. A dirty fix would be to copy the code which moves the legs for the torso and the head. Once we start animating them as well, though, the code would become needlessly complex. Luckily, there's a much cleaner solution. It's called parenting. No, you don't need to call your dad to fix the code. I'm talking about parenting the sprites. We can give a sprite a parent. Moving the parent will also move all child sprites. This is ideal for our situation. Set the legs as the parent of the torso sprite. Next, set the parent of the head sprite to be the torso. We have now created a hierarchy of sprites, with the legs as the base, then the torso, and lastly the head. When we play, we see that nothing has changed. However, if we had moved the sprites using their coordinates directly, we would have noticed drastic changes. That's because of something called relative positioning. Previously, if we had set the location of a sprite to the coordinates 0, 0, it would have appeared at the bottom left of the screen. But when sprites have parents, 0, 0 becomes the center of the parent sprite. Now if we move the legs, both the torso and the head move with them. If we move the torso, only the head will move with it because it's the only child sprite. And if we move the head, no other sprites move with it because it has no children. This concept of parenting is ubiquitous throughout software development, so make sure you understand it well. It can be confusing at first, but once well understood, it will make your life easier. Let's change the movement of the legs. We don't want our character to slide off screen, so let's move the legs left and right continuously. To do that, we employ the help of our trusty sign function. Remember it from last episode? I don't blame you if you don't, because that episode came out months ago. Here's a quick refresher. Sign functions look like waves. Imagine the x-axis as a timeline and the y-axis as the position of the legs. You can see that they alternate between two points for all eternity instead of moving in just one direction. If we set the x value to a sine function and set its parameter to be the current time, we can see that the character moves from left to right. Time.time is a value that measures how long Unitale has been running. The time object keeps track of the time so you don't have to do it yourself. For the movement, we will use the moveTo function this time around. This one will position the character relative to the bottom left corner of the screen. Since the center of the screen is at x equals 320, add 320 to the x value and set y to legs.y so they stay in place vertically. The sine function doesn't move the character that much, so multiply it by something like 10 or 15. We can also use sines to create a bouncing animation for our legs. Scale them using a similar function. This time, change the y value with a sine function so our legs grow and shrink vertically. Add 1 to the sine function and multiply it by 0.1, so the effect is a lot more subtle. Set x to 1. However, the legs now scale up and down, which doesn't make them appear grounded. Let's fix that by setting the leg's pivot point. As I said in part 6, the pivot point is the point a sprite rotates and scales around. Set the pivot to 0.5 and 0, which is at the bottom center. But now our legs have moved up, which just looks goofy, so we need to adjust their height. But our torso and head don't move up and down with the legs. Looking at the documentation, there's a function called setAnchor, which is very useful when moving a parent sprite and making the child sprite stick to a certain edge of it. That's exactly what we want to do. Set the torso's anchor to 0.5 and 1, which is at the top center of the legs. Because our legs only move up, we want the torso to be centered above them and moving as well. You can imagine a little point on the parent sprite similar to the pivot. It moves when the sprite moves or gets scaled. The legs only scale upwards, so the anchor point at the top moves along with them. Child sprites stick to it, which is why our torso now sticks to the top of the legs. Setting our anchor to 0,0 would anchor our torso at the bottom left of the legs, for instance. The torso would also stop moving, because the legs don't move downward and the anchor point stays in place. Set anchor only works on sprites with a parent and also affects a sprite's position when the parent uses move to or changes its x and y coordinates. Anyways, our torso now moves with the legs, but it's positioned too far up. Move it and the head down a little and our character slides and bounces, making him look much more alive than before. Let's animate the head. But instead of moving or scaling it, we will swap the head sprite. To swap a sprite, call the setAnimation function on the head object. This function takes a table of sprites and performs frame-by-frame animation with each sprite being a frame. The time between frames and seconds is specified after that. For our example, we have 3 head sprites, so add them all to the table. The table starts and ends with curly brackets, and all table objects are separated by commas. Once again, add the sprite names without the .png at the end and set the time between frames to 1 second. Be aware that there has to be a comma between the closing curly bracket and the number as well. Now our character changes expressions every second. How cool is that? And there we have it, our fully animated character. I hope you've learned something from this tutorial and didn't walk away empty-handed. I hope to see you next episode, so stay tuned. Speaking of tunes, the next episode will be about music. Creator out.